Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to start us just a bit early so I can make sure our debaters have their time allotted to them. My name is Howard Mutter. On my right is Brandon Church. On my left is Bernie Taylor. Mm-hmm. And we're going to find out tonight, does the whale fossil record show evolution? At least we're going to debate that issue. If you look at your program, the agenda says at 7:30 we start the debate. 6:30. 6:30 we'll start the debate. Brandon Church will have the first opening statement. I can't read. I'm sorry. You guys keep me honest. Bernie Taylor will have the opening statement. He'll have 10 minutes. We'll watch that. Try to keep that close on time. Brandon will follow, have 10 minutes. Bernie then will ask Brandon two questions. And I assume are those
Sure two questions. It's just person two. Basically 10 minutes worth of questions. Or is it 5 minutes?
5 minutes. Five.
Yeah. Just got a chance with this. Okay. Person one asks. Bernie will ask Brandon questions for 5 minutes, and Brandon has a chance to ask Bernie questions for 5 minutes. 7 o'clock, they're through, and we'll field questions from the audience. We have about 40 minutes. It says 45. If we hold it to about 40, give these guys a couple of minutes each for closing statement. We have to be out of the room by 8 o'clock, and it has to be clean, chair stacked up, so appreciate any help you give on that, and we have to vacate. So if you can stick around for just 3 minutes and help us get that, it would be appreciated. And we are just about timely now. Our first debater, first number one, is Bernie. Are you ready to go?
Yeah.
Like me. If you guys don't have my handout, there are copies on the table by the entrance.
Yeah, but you're the timer.
Okay, so to start with, I have a few disclaimers. I'm going to go through these slides. I have a lot of them. I'm going to go through them really fast. Later when I post this on YouTube, you'll have a chance to pause and look at these in more detail. Some of the highlights. I want to say that I don't speak for atheists, all atheists, just like Brandon doesn't speak for all theists or not even all Christians. So if you're an atheist or a secular humanist and you don't agree with me, that's you're in good company. There's a lot of, there's not one speaker that everybody agrees with. Another thing is this isn't only about science, or doesn't have to be. If Brandon wants to talk theology, I'm interested in going there also. And I also wanted to say this is not a life and death situation, so just relax and enjoy it mentally. Don't feel like you have to defend your beliefs or the world's going to come to an end tonight. And just thank you for attending, because if you didn't attend and we weren't, my opponent wasn't here and my moderator wasn't here, we wouldn't have a meeting. So thanks for being a part of this. My presentation outline is, number one, I'm going to talk about our two choices. Part two, the positive case for whale evolution. Part three, some creationist complaints. And finally, a summary, which will be after back and forth. Okay. I want to impress upon you that you really, you can see this as you have two choices. Either God made everything by a miracle, poof, there's a animal, poof, there's another one, poof, there's another one. Or animals came about through evolution, either theistic or atheistically. So really, it's in the big picture, there's two ways to look at it. So don't just think of this as anti-evolution or accepting evolution. The alternative, if you don't want to go for that, I'm saying it's creationism, that God did these poofs. Now, you know, if anybody said, well, you know, Prometheus was the God who made all the humans, you'd probably all snicker and say, yeah, what a myth. But, if you think that sounds silly, consider that Christians say it was Jesus who made everything. There's a couple Bible verses how it says everything was made by Jesus. So this means Jesus made the whales, the trees, he even made the people, and he became a person. So something to consider. This slide talks about some of the ramifications of a creation by POOF, what's called fiat, or emerging through by evolution. So when it comes to whales, it's pretty amazing. Either, you know, again, God either made the dolphins poof, a killer whale poof, a baleen whale poof, or else the evolutionary story is life gradually arose in the sea. It made its way onto land. These land animals emerged into mammals. Then the mammals went back into the sea again. So now you have like a great white shark, which is a fish, and a killer whale, which is a mammal. And the killer whale is actually closer as a relative to a hippo than it is to the great white fish, the great white shark. So it's an interesting picture. This slide here basically shows a scale of how things, depending on how much science you want to accept, is how you're going to interpret the Bible. So if you want to reject all of modern cosmology and biology, you could be a younger creationist. If you want to accept all of cosmology, you could be an older creationist. If you want to accept it all and still believe in God, you can be a theistic evolutionist or an evolutionary creationist. And if you want to go further, then you can say, well, you know, there's no God either. There's no evidence for that. So now you're a theistic evolutionist. I pretty much went through all these gaps myself. I started off partial to the younger creationism and went down that slide there. And but that's not to say people think it's, you know, that you can be a Christian and be an evolutionist or a scientist. This shows the ramifications of your hypothesis. The Young Earth hypothesis, top left, says that all these plants, birds, everything were made about 6,000 years ago. Poof, 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 poof. The Old Earth creationist says, no, no, there's times, like there's an epoch where the first land and plants were made, then whales and fish and birds, and then humans. The bottom right one talks about this is what the actual fossil record says. So the fossil record conflicts even with the one above it for the Old Earth creationists. For example, the Old Earth, well, there's different ways that these apologists will defend this, but you can see, for example, it says, obviously, that the land came before the animals. Well, obviously, the fish were here before the land plants, according to the fossil record. Now, the point of this by Dr. Lamoureux, who's my favorite theologian when I was a Christian, he says, look at the bottom left one. He says, there's no prediction if you're an evolutionary creationist. He says that's because the Bible is not a text, is not a scientific textbook, and it's not a history textbook. It's a theology textbook, and therefore it says nothing about science. So as soon as you try to make it say something about science, you're going to have all kinds of troubles. So the interesting thing is that's what Brandon's going to be doing, is he's going to be trying to look to the Bible as a major scientific input tonight. So just some interesting things about whales, and this is incredible. It's amazing. All of these whales, dolphins, and porpoises are actually mammals, like the land mammals. And they evolved rather rapidly, and rapidly means 8 million years, scientifically speaking. And they're fully aquatic, which means they can't live outside water. They breathe air with lungs, totally different than the sharks or the fish. They birth live young, and they nurse them. And for example, they have hair in the early stages of development, and they have some hair on the outside also. In certain places. So now I'm going to talk about the positive case for whale evolution. First off, there's an admission that, yeah, there is a lot of problem with fossils, and the reason why primarily is because there's not very many fossils, and the world was so much different within the ancient days. For example, in India, when this whale evolution was happening, India wasn't yet even attached to the continent. And there was ancient local seas. India collided with Asia and created the Himalayan mountains, and it brought marine fossils up with them. So this shows you the kind of environment, how it was totally different than what we're seeing today, which illustrates the big impact of how you see the world. Is it only 6,000 years old or billions of years old? This is from Dr. Thewissen. He's a leading world-renowned expert, and this is his chart. The bottom part of this tree shows the fossils and his ordering of it. And then you can see this major branch where we basically have the baleen whales as a group and the toothed whales as a group. So these are the ones that are called extant or alive today, the top two branches. So the bottom ones, it's actually very complicated. Dr. Thewissen on his website even says how complicated this is, giving an illustration, for example. You know, if you had a bunch of women and you're trying to say which one's a sister, which one's a mother, which one's a grandmother, it's very difficult. So anyway, there is kind of a general understanding of what's going on here. Traditionally, there's 9 lines of independent existence, independent evidence for whale evolution, for example, on talktorigins.org. I'll say some of these, but I don't have time to, and I'll ask, if you want to ask questions later, we can talk about them, but paleontological evidence is basically the fossil records, or the ancient extinct fossils. Morphological evidence is specifically actually looking at the feet of the different animals and the anvil of the middle ear is what they're using to determine their placement. Another one is the molecular biological evidence. In 2003, there was an interesting paper with mitochondrial DNA analysis that was quite thorough. Number 4, vestigial evidence. These are leftovers from evolution. For example, a whale having a femur, that's a major leg bone. They don't have legs, it's just a total leftover. Also, some of these whales have muscles through their ears, but they don't have ears. That's from when they're land mammals and they can direct their ears. There's some other ones too. Embryological evidence. This shows basically looking at how it develops in the womb. For example, if you look at the baleen whale, when it develops in the womb, it grows teeth. And then before it's born, it sheds its teeth. So why would God make something poof, you know, so that when it develops in the womb, it grows something that totally doesn't need later on. But from an evolutionary standpoint, it makes sense because that's the way structures evolve and work with each other. Geochemical evidence has to do with analyzing, for example, the bones, and especially the teeth, and they can determine from isotopic ratios of oxygen whether it lived in freshwater or saltwater. Paleo-environmental evidence talks about the kind of other fossils that are in line and found along with it. This basically says the things that they look at when they look at fossils, like for example the skull changing, the shape of the teeth changing, the position of the nostrils moving backwards, things like that. This is something I can ask or talk more about in the Q&A time, but this really shows how the hippopotamus, according to the DNA analysis, is really close to the whales. Okay, so I'm pretty much out of time. So basically, one thing I just want to mention is I had my own theory too, and this is the handout I gave you, and I asked the professor DeWeesen, who's a world-renowned expert in Ohio, 2 things, and that is if you compared, for example, a killer whale and a great white shark, they're about the same size, but you would expect the killer whale to be more like the hippo or the dolphin than the shark when it comes to looking at the eyes, the brain, and the laryngeal nerve, which is an interesting artifact from evolution. So all the details are on your readout there, and you can read that during the presentations and ask a question about it. But that's it. Yeah, okay, thank you.
All right. Well, I would like to start by discussing how evolutionary relationships are determined, how they build up those trees. Most often this is done by comparing anatomical traits among different creatures. The similarities are supposed to show us how closely creatures are related. The more similarities we find, the closer these creatures probably are. For example, every primate has 10 fingers and 10 toes. Evolutionists say that's because they all evolved from a common ancestor that has 10 fingers and 10 toes. The problem is different scientists compare different similarities and end up with different evolutionary relationships. And this actually happens a lot. It's one of the big sources of debate among evolutionary biologists. Another problem is that there are a lot of cases where creatures have things in common, but evolutionists say those similarities have nothing to do with relationships. Instead, it's thought they came about completely at random. Some good examples are the wings of birds, bats, insects, and flying reptiles. None of these animals are thought to be closely related, but they all have very specialized features that are very similar. So the question is, if similarities are supposed to show close relationship, what do we do with these cases? Evolutionists call this convergent evolution. Similarities are just coincidence. They're based on random chance, nothing more. Well, there are a few problems with this idea. First of all, convergent evolution is very unlikely. Hundreds of thousands of random genetic mutations might be needed to evolve a new feature. And to say this happens several times, each time arriving at the same feature, is pretty ridiculous. A second problem is that convergent evolution makes the theory very flexible. How do we know if similarities mean relationship or convergence? It's based on the whims of the scientists. Someone can say two creatures are related because of certain similarities, but if someone else disagrees, they can always say, no, those similarities are due to random convergence. They're just random mutations. So scientists have an incredible amount of freedom to make the evolutionary trees look the way they want. Getting to the whales now, the first thing to consider is where they started. Since the 1960s, it's been thought they evolved from a group of animals called mesonochids. These are extinct wolf-like creatures that were similar to whales in their teeth and in parts of their skulls. A Scientific American article from 2004 said, quote, meanwhile, another group of paleontologists recovered a lower jaw fragment and isolated teeth that bolstered the link to mesonochids through strong dental similarities. Enter the biochemists. They think they found a link between the whales and a group of mammals called artiodactyls, a group that includes the hippos. In 1999, an article from Scientific American said, quote, the most recent genetic evidence provides the strongest support yet for the hypothesis that whales and hippopotamuses are first cousins. If true, this would slice these marine animals from their long-standing position on the mammalian family tree and graft them onto a different branch. From the fossil bones, however, paleontologists see no need to cut into the mammalian tree. So this debate's gone on for a while. Were the whales descended from mesonochids or artiodactyls? Well, they decided there was something that could resolve the issue. There's a certain ankle bone that takes a certain shape only in artiodactyls. If we could find this feature in the so-called ancient whales, we would know that's where they came from. So eventually we did find that feature. Scientists now say that, yeah, the whales came from artiodactyls. But wait a minute, what about those similarities that the mesonochid teeth had to the whale teeth? Well, now evolutionists are saying that doesn't really matter. In 2001, whale expert Philip Gingrich wrote, although there is a general resemblance of the teeth of archaeocetes, that's ancient whales, to those of mesonochids, such resemblance is sometimes overstated and evidently represents evolutionary convergence. So you see what happened here? First they said the teeth similarities were strong, now they're general and overstated. It's a good example of the freedom and flexibility that convergent evolution gives the scientists. Doesn't matter what similarities they find or how close they are, if the scientists want to dismiss them in favor of another theory, they can. Now, when we get to the line of the so-called ancient whales, what we find are some creatures that look nothing like whales, and then we find whales. Specific sequence is a matter of debate, but it usually starts with Pachycetus. According to a 2001 Nature article written by whale expert Hans Weissen, these animals had a size, shape, and behavior very similar to wolves. He said Pachycetus were terrestrial mammals no more amphibious than a tapir. Next in line is Ambulocetus, and by the way, you have all this on your handout. According to a 2004 Scientific American article, Ambulocetus was basically a crocodile, around 10 feet long, I might add. Then there are Remingtonocetids, which are only known by fragments, but in 2009, Weissen said they were a lot like river otters. Then there are Protocetids, which includes the genus Rhodocetus. Whale expert Philip Gingrich said Rhodocetus was similar to a large desmid, that's a semi-aquatic mole. And then we have Durodonts. According to a 2001 National Geographic propaganda piece, Evolution of Whales, the Durodonts, quote, were full-fledged fluke-lashing cetaceans that gave birth at sea. So we go from a wolf to a crocodile to an otter to a semi-aquatic mole to a whale. And that's supposed to show some kind of step-by-step evolution. Now, evolutionists like to talk about certain features that seem to show some progression among the animals, changes in their nostrils and legs and things like that. Some traits do seem to show a kind of path. But evolutionists are completely missing the big picture. We go from a wolf to a crocodile to an otter to an aquatic mole to a whale. A small portion of their features may show progression in a few big steps, but most of their features do not. There's far more evidence that these were individual, unrelated creatures than there is for an evolutionary path. As a matter of fact, we could take any collection of objects and arrange them so that a few of their features show step-by-step changes. But in most cases, the majority of their traits would seem to fluctuate wildly. They would not show us any kind of a path because there is no real path there. That's what we find with the whales. And by the way, evolutionists do acknowledge that huge gaps exist. In 2003, Gingrich wrote, it is undoubtedly simplistic to treat the evolution of Eocene archaeocetes in the whole land-to-sea transition of early whales in two major steps. But this reflects the state of our knowledge. Perhaps the size of the gaps that separate artiodactyls from Rhodocetus and Rhodocetus from Durodon will serve as encouragement to search for and study better specimens of additional genera. I'd like to spend a few minutes talking about a recent study that tried to find the best tree for whale evolution. Since 1988, scientists have done 16 big studies on the whales, comparing anatomical traits, DNA sequences, and so on. The most recent was published in 2008. It was by far the most extensive. It compared 635 anatomical traits and over 40,000 molecular sequences among 71 different animals. And they tried to find the best arrangement of the animals that would give them the most parsimonious tree. In other words, the best tree, the tree that would show the best progression of these traits from one animal to the next. Now, not only is there disagreement among the 16 studies, there's a lot of disagreement within the studies themselves. Every one of them comes up with several trees that they consider the most parsimonious. In other words, there are numerous arrangements that all tie for the highest score. In the 2008 study, they found 168 most parsimonious trees. So how do we know which one's right? What's more, the authors found 16 animals that bounced around wildly, even within these best trees. They called them unstable, and they dropped them from their final analysis. They didn't know what to do with them. And by the way, two of those animals were Ambulocetus and Rhodocetus. The 2008 study also found strong support for certain groupings that contradict long-held beliefs about whale evolution. For example, you remember artiodactyls are supposed to be recognized by this special ankle bone. But mesonotrichs have a lot of skeletal and dental features in common with the modern whales, but they don't have that ankle bone, so the scientists decided, well, they're not related to whales. Those teeth similarities, that was convergent evolution, nothing more. However, this study said, quote, the strict consensus showed that all members of the fully extinct clade Mesonotrichia were more closely related to whales than was any other living or extinct taxon. So how can mesonotrichs be more closely related to whales if they're not even artiodactyls? Well, the authors decided they are artiodactyls, even though they don't have that special ankle. They even said, oh, we shouldn't be putting so much emphasis on that ankle. Really? That was a major key in the whole debate from the late 90s. Now we're just going to throw it out? Again, evolutionists can throw out the data whenever it doesn't fit their theories. And by the way, as a side note, the 2008 study also found contradictions with the standard evolutionary trees for horses and pigs. I'll just mention one more interesting thing here. The researchers found that the test scores were much higher when they just tested modern whales than when they included the ancient whales. And that's exactly what creationism would predict. The Bible says God created plants and animals in distinct kinds. There may have been just one original whale kind. Maybe there were two or three. We don't know for sure. But all the modern whale species would have diverged from them. They are closely related. But creationists would not say they're related to the so-called ancient whales, the wolves, the crocodiles, and the other things. And the tests fully support that view. So the studies do not support evolution. They actually support creation. How much time do I have?
2 minutes.
2 minutes? Wow. All right, well, let me mention a few other things. Something else I found interesting about these 16 studies, scientists will study comparative anatomy. They do morphological studies where they look at animals' different features, the bones, for example. They'll look at the length and the shape, size of the bones, the width, look at their weights, the angles they make, how round or how flat they are, and things like that. They'll measure all of these things. But that's not what these 16 studies did. If you look at their criteria, they have things like, does the animal have a collarbone, yes or no? Does it have a femur, yes or no? They go into very little detail. And so it's really pretty ridiculous. It seems like they're just glossing over a lot of details. They don't seem to care about the length of the femur, the kind of the curve that it makes, or much of anything in the way of details. They just care if it exists. And all of these details could fluctuate wildly, but the fact that it has it, that's all they care about. So if these features did fluctuate wildly, it would make this look even less like a path going from one creature to another. It would bring in even more randomness, more evidence that the creatures are not related along the supposed path. Apparently they don't want to see that. That's the only reason I can think of why they don't consider the length of a femur. They should consider whether it has a femur or not. So. All right. Yeah, I think that's probably good for now. I'll get more into this. But these 16 studies, as big as they are, as much of work as they put into them, and they really don't tell us much. Okay. Thank you.
Bernie?
Okay.
5 minutes to ask questions.
Okay. Okay, first off, I think people in the audience, if you feel frustrated for example, I really like the DNA evidence. I really eat it up because it's such a precious thing, because since 2000, before 2000, we didn't really have anything, and now we have this wealth of information. In fact, I have a slide where you can even go online and do your own DNA comparisons for free. It's written as a tutorial for kids to do for a science fair project. It just shows you the power of DNA. It's kind of frustrating for me. I haven't heard of this criticism before. And people at previous debates said, you know, they don't like somebody saying, oh, that's interesting, I'll get back to you. You know, why didn't you talk about this beforehand? So I just wanted to note that I did ask Brandon if he wanted to meet beforehand, and he said he didn't think that would be a good idea. So do you want to explain why you didn't want to talk about this beforehand so we could both come up to speed on this?
Yeah, we've done online debates. After the last debate we did together, we got on the internet, we did a fair amount of online debating. And one of the things that I noted from time to time, it doesn't seem like, from my perspective, it doesn't look like evolutionists really look at what creationists have to say much. They don't, you know, read the creationist literature. They don't, you know, look on the creationist websites. A lot of stuff you can find for free. Creationists know quite a bit about evolution, at least I do. Maybe not all of us. But I felt like, you know, I'm doing my homework. I'm doing my research. And, you know, evolutionists don't want to look at what creationists have to say. They just want to, you know, believe what they want to believe and not really hear the opposition. And now that we're coming up to a debate, you know, Bernie was interested in hearing more about what I had to say, and I basically emailed him and said, you know, you can find this stuff online. I'm doing my research, you know, do your research.
Okay, and I didn't really do a whole lot of research because I was so busy trying to get the positive case and all that, but one thing I did do is I found out a very prominent guy was Jonathan Sefardi, so I bought both of his books used, Refuting Evolution 1 and 2, and there's not a word of this stuff about DNA that he brought up. So it's just kind of I kind of see it as like a sneak attack kind of thing, like here's something that he's not going to be able to rebut because he hasn't had something to plan for. The second thing I want to bring up was, I have the handout here about this, the recurrent, recurrent laryngeal nerve. Now what that is, in fish, there's this nerve that goes from the brain past the heart to its gill area. And what happened is, the fish creatures or whatever came on the land became land animals, what happened is this one nerve got stuck. And so what happened is this one nerve goes down all the way from the head down to the heart and back up again to where it needs to go into the neck. And there's an interesting YouTube video about this with Dawkins where they dissect a giraffe, I believe it is, you know. So it's going down an extra 15 feet back, you know, it's like extra 15 foot route. So now, if it's true that mammals went back into the water, you would think, okay, well, the mammals would have this. So if you compared a great white shark and a dolphin or killer whale or something, the shark ought to have a direct connection and the dolphin ought to have this really long path because it, you know, came from the land. So anyway, I asked Dr. Thiessen about that, and that's one of the things on here. He said, recurrent laryngeal nerve, I'm not aware of anybody having dissected that in a killer whale, but I have seen it in a bowhead whale, even bigger than a killer whale, and it indeed runs around the aorta on the right side of the body as it does in all other mammals too, into the chest and back up again to the neck. So that's a very long course. So, I mean, this is the kind of thing where you say if God's an intelligent designer, he's a very bad designer, because instead of thinking a nice, just a nice trip, but you know, take a trip from. So what do you say about that?
Okay. First of all, what is the purpose of the thing going all the way down and coming back up? Is there a design improvement? Is there something beneficial to that?
Yeah, basically it's supposed to go from point A to point B, which is like something like this probably, mm-hmm. but instead it goes down and wraps around the heart and back up, because in the fish it was a direct route.
Is there a benefit to that though?
No, there's no benefit.
Do we know that for sure?
Yeah.
Really? Mm-hmm. Okay. My background is in electronics, and I happen to know that nerves, nothing electricity, sometimes there is a benefit to have longer things versus shorter things, longer antennas, for example, better tuned for certain things. I'm not suggesting the killer whales, you know, receive radio waves, but I'm saying there are beneficial reasons for this and that, where at first appearance it might not seem so. There are a lot of cases where we don't know what the benefit is. Can I answer the question?
Okay.
There are a lot of cases where we don't know what the benefit is, but to suppose there is no benefit, Bernie and some, you know, evolutionists, they talk, like to talk about the God of the gaps. Whenever we don't know the answer to something, creationists just assume it's God. God did it because we don't know the answer. But it's kind of the same thing. Whenever we don't know the answer to something, evolutionists just assume, oh, it doesn't have a purpose. Therefore, it can't have been intelligently designed. So I don't know what the purpose of that is, but there might be a purpose. And to suggest that you know, it's a flaw is, I think that's, I don't know if that's a guess. That's not really supportive of evolution.
Brandon, you have 5 minutes to ask questions of Bernie.
Okay. So, yeah, when we look at these studies, these large studies that have been done. Oh, and by the way, as far as me kind of ambushing you because you didn't know what I was going to say, I didn't know what you were going to say either, so I do think it's fair.
But I offered to disclose that.
Right, but I declined, so I still think it's fair. Neither one of us know. Why don't the DNA and the fossil evidence line up very well? I mean, when we look at these studies that have been done, and the most recent one, 2008, they're still finding this. But all of these studies where they're comparing hundreds of morphological traits, thousands of DNA traits, when they put the tree together for the anatomy, it, you know, it scores a certain way. And then when we put they put the DNA, the molecular data with it, all of a sudden the scores drop. It's like they're conflicting. And they don't know how to reconcile that. So I'm wondering, from an evolutionist point of view, shouldn't all lines of evidence, you know, there's going to be anomalies here and there, but in general, shouldn't they all kind of converge on the same information?
See, my understanding is that there's quite a few points about this. One is that when they do a DNA analysis, that kind of trumps it all because that's really a harder science where you can kind of see relationships. But also, there is a very scarcity of fossils, for one thing, and also, like I said earlier, if you go to Dr. Thewissen's website, he has a picture there, like I said earlier, that if you had a bunch of women, it's really hard to sort out, even in a few generations, who's the sister, who's the mother, and who's the granddaughter. And like in Wales, you have 1,500 generations. But regardless of the exact descent, you can kind of see general trends. For example, there's a certain kind of creature that's in a local area, and as it gets branching out more, it's found more globally. And when it's found more globally, they look at the teeth and they find the ratios of the isotopes to show that's, you know, a marine animal, and the local ones is more of a freshwater kind of thing.
Okay.
And also, I wanted to say, like with PBS shows and stuff like that, they do oversimplify it. If you listen to them, they talk really slow and they make you nice pictures because they're trying to give the general audience an idea. They don't go into all the details. And Dr. Thewissen himself even talks about these different hypotheses, and it's kind of still up for grabs exactly how it goes. But
I think when it comes to the paleo environments, you're completely right. If you look at, for example, a creature that lived by the rivers and a creature that lived in shallow seas, and then one that goes out to the ocean, they are going to show a progression seemingly toward the seas, but that doesn't mean they evolved from one to the next to the next. That just shows these lived by the rivers, these lived by the seas, these lived in the oceans. But I want to come back to you mentioned the DNA data. It kind of trumps the fossil data. So it doesn't really answer why the two lines of evidence disagree, but we'll go with that for now. The DNA data trumps the fossil data. You know, the fossil trees, the evolutionary trees that have been built up over the last 150 plus years are based on the fossils. Does that mean all of those are suspect?
You mean the current trees of descent are?
All of them, yeah.
Well,
because essentially they're built up of the fossils, yeah. But the DNA
disagrees. Well, my understanding
disagrees.
Is that the DNA probably reworked some of that, and I think it's, I don't think there's big discrepancies with DNA as far as I've heard.
No, that's not what these things are showing.
You're talking about all life or just whales?
Well, whales is what we've looked into so far. I mean, there's a lot that we don't know. A lot of, you know, animals that we could do these studies on, but scientists have been focusing on whales. But if it's going to be reworking the whale line, for example, the mesonachids, now they're saying that the mesonachids should be closer to the whales than anything else, which was contrary to what they were saying.
They're not saying that now. That's what they used to say.
That's what the 2008 study just said. It says contrary to what, you know, people have been saying. And in fact, it said contrary to what Gingrich and them said. There is not good evidence that they are close to the hippos. So this 2008 study, yeah, that's on my, that's the very top of my handout. So take a look at that.
30 seconds. Well, see, that's not what the Wiesen would say. He's like the preeminent whale experts.
Okay.
In fact, you know, that's what I have in my handout. I have a handout of the fossil record according to the Wiesen.
So there are definite differences among in opinions, what you're saying.
I didn't know there's a big dispute with the Wiesen. So what, the hypothesis exactly the fossil order is not clear. Yeah, it's not totally worked out yet. But I think there's some general overview.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, we're ready to move into the audience question and answer. Let me make an example by standing up.
And if you would please stand up, state your question nice and loudly. Try to keep it short so that the debaters have time to respond and they can direct it to the debaters. Is that right?
You can tell me how do you want to do it? You're an expert moderator, right?
Oh, no.
I heard some rumors about you.
So you can direct it to either one or put it to the two, and I'll split it up.
Yeah, so we're going to go on for how long?
We're going to go till 20 minutes till. I'm going to try to stop it then so that they have time for a closing statement. And then remember, we have to clean up the room, put the chairs away, and exit by 8 o'clock, okay? They lock us in.
Okay. If land animals came from the sea.
I'm sorry, who are you directing your question? Okay, to Bernie?
You have some sea animal, mammal, or non-mammal moving onto the land, wandering around there for a few million years, and deciding he doesn't like it, and he was back in the ocean. Now, what came from the sea into the land, and then from the land into the sea? How do you run them together? And what backs up thoroughly the theory?
Yeah, that's one of the things on there. So there's like 8 lines of evidence. One of them is called the chronological kind of line of evidence. And basically, there's a good story about why the mammals would go into the sea again, and that's because the dinosaur extinction around that time, there were reptiles that actually also went back into the sea, and they're pretty much all extinct now. So when the dinosaurs and those reptiles died out, the mammals found this open niche and they exploited it, I guess. So that's actually another line of evidence, is what was happening in that epoch of time.
Would you like to respond?
Could I?
Sure.
How do you want to work this?
Yeah. Equal chance. Equal opportunity.
All right. So, when it comes to the chronology, the sequence of fossils and that kind of thing, you mentioned that we don't, you know, there's a lot we don't know. We know the big picture, and I would suggest we don't really even know the big picture. When we find a fossil, and let's say they date this thing at 30 million years, does that mean this creature evolved 30 million years ago, or this creature evolved at least 30 million years ago? Evolutionists would say, well, it could have come about before then. This is the first occurrence of it. So it's possible that all of these go back further. We just don't have the fossil evidence of that. The fact that they do these studies, part of what they're doing in sorting out these traits and trying to determine the evolutionary trees, trying to determine the order that the fossils occurred in. So just because we find Pachycetus and an Ambulocetus doesn't mean that Pachycetus came before Ambulocetus. It could be vice versa. The chronology is not all that well worked out. The chronology is actually, I would suggest, it is subservient to the theory. They want to find what works best for evolutionary theory, and you know whether we find that specific order in the fossil record or not doesn't so much matter. You look at the two evolutionary trees that I have on my handout. Okay. And they do disagree in some points. Others disagree in other points. So they're still trying to work out, the chronology, the sequence of these things. It's not so cut and dry.
Can I make just a quick comment, and then he can comment on that? I think this is kind of interesting that you say that these fossils, in the big picture, don't work out. And I can quote you Dr. DeWiesen, or the Weiss, I'm not sure how you say it, but he can say very confidently, it's that's the way it is.
So who is there to rebut that? It's not, I don't see another scientist rebutting that. It's like, is it a young earther who is not trained in anatomy who's going to rebut that scientifically?
Let's look at this logically. Why do the fossils supposedly work out this way? It's because it works for evolutionary theory, right? Pachycetus, Ambulocetus, and so on and so forth. It does not fit to say, well, the whale came first, and then there was the proto-whale, and then there was... No, this is what works, but that doesn't necessarily mean that this is the order that we find these creatures in. So there are articles where Philip Gingrich, who is the other, Weiss and Gingrich, the two whale experts, Gingrich disagrees with some of the dating that has come up, and that was back about 10 years ago. I don't know if he's changed his mind.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to limit these so that we can get more. I know I'm going to try to remember who had hands up first, but I'm going to go with you next.
Oh, good. So, question to Brandon. So you're aware that something like 99% of all the species that ever lived are now extinct, right?
Right.
And you mentioned a whole bunch of, you know, primitive proto-whales and long-extinct animals and all that stuff. And mm-hmm. they go from, you know, more less whale-like to more whale-like in every aspect. So if they were all specially created, what's God doing practicing all this time? Couldn't he just kind of get it right the first time?
Okay. So they go from more less whale-like to more whale-like in every aspect. I would direct you to the second page of my handout. The traits actually meander a lot. And I've got three examples, three charts that were published in an article by Dr. Thwaisen. And you can see the lines that they take. It's not just this nice smooth path. They go here and that, you know, down, up and down and all of that. So there is not this nice smooth path. As I mentioned, a few of their features do seem to show a bit of a path. But each one of these, number one, each one of these creatures was an individual unique. I mean, you have a crocodile, it's well suited to the lifestyle that it had. You had a river otter, it's well suited to the lifestyle that it had. So they were well suited. It was not as though God was having to practice. The other thing, you know, these features bounce all around. The 2008 study found over 23% of the anatomical traits will reverse course. In other words, if you look at the supposed sequence of creatures, one creature has some feature, the next one doesn't, the next one does again. So it just reversed. And they'll do this at least once, sometimes go back and forth over and over. A study from 1999 had 24% of the features reversing. A study from 98 had 31% reversing. So these things, they're bouncing all around. They're changing totally at random. They don't seem to be progressing from a, you know, something toward a whale. They're just all over the place. We would find the same thing if, for example, you were to do an evolutionary tree of vehicles. You know, line them up according to engine size, for example. And their traits are just going to fluctuate wildly because there's no real path there. That's what we see with the whales.
Well, does that show God's indecision? Or?
Okay.
Shows intelligent design.
Yeah. Well, I'll make one, I guess, comment is, you know, I'm not really familiar with these charts and everything, but I mean, this one here, it looks like it's not too bad of an ascent, and it sounds like you're portraying like these are all descendants, and a lot of these are not descendants, they're like sister groups, they're like distant cousins, and sometimes these things interbreed and all kinds of things, so I don't think it's fair to say what I expect to see is a straight line. If it's not a straight line, it's not right.
Those charts are according to the basic tree we have here, Pachycetus, Ambulocetus, Remington seeded, Proto-seeded.
I mean, so they should like the eye size, for example. I mean, it seems like there's a good trend there.
But it bounces down and back up.
Yeah, because they're not exactly ancestors. They
should be.
They're different relatives or sister groups and things like that.
So it goes from Pachycetus to Ambulocetus to Remington acetus to Proto-seeded and then on to Basilosauria, which is grouped in with Durodon. That is supposed to be the path.
No, it doesn't mean like it's a tree where you get branches.
But this is supposed to be the sequence. Pachycetus to Ambulocetus to Remington acetus to Proto-seedus to the Durodons and Basilosaurus, which is grouped in in Thwaisen's article with Durodon.
Yeah, well, in my slides I had the Dr. Thwaisen's actual chart, so you can see what the line is. So, for example, this Basilosaurus. Sauridae and Durodontidae, they're parallel groups. They're not
in mind of the
Those are supposed to be landmarks along the path toward
Right. See, these guys have a common ancestor, but this is not the ancestor of this. It branched off. These are all branches. So it's. I'm just saying it could be more complicated than expecting to see a straight line.
Okay.
Okay. We'll go on to another. Ladies first.
Thank you. Hello, this question is for Mr. Church. I'm wondering how you would answer how natural selection fits in with evolution based on an example of a study out of England about 200 years ago. During the Industrial Revolution, the white moths, who when the city was dirtier due to pollution, white moths were spotted by their animals and eaten, so all the moths became dark. When they cleaned the city up, all the moths became white again, which is a really good example for how evolution works. You might be adapted well, and then your environment changes, and therefore you disappear, or people who happen to have a certain mutation end up growing. You know, excuse me for not explaining that very well, but I wonder how you would answer that.
Three things to say about that. First of all, the peppered moth study, it was found to be a hoax. They glued the moths onto the trees to do the study. But I'll answer the general question of natural selection and how it fits into creation and how it fits into evolution. Creationists completely agree with natural selection. We do see that if a creature has a trait that is favorable for survival, it will tend to survive, and the descendants will have those traits. If a creature has some traits that are not favorable to survival, it's probably going to die early, will leave less offspring, and eventually those unfavorable traits will be removed from the gene pool. We see that. Creationists completely agree with that. When it comes to the evolution, monkey to man style of evolution, though, natural selection is not sufficient to do that. Because what natural selection does, it takes the traits that you already have, the variability that's already there, and it will favor these and it will not favor these. Well, in order to go from, you know, a monkey to man, to a fish to a man, or, you know, that kind of thing, eventually a fish to a man, you need new information for the DNA. You need to add information. So that is where evolutionists would say genetic mutations come in. And creationists have a problem with that. We do not see genetic mutations really doing anything helpful. There are a few cases here and there with minor things. But we should be seeing a tremendous amount of benefit. We should be seeing a tremendous amount of evolution right now. And we could probably get into that. How much time do you have? Go ahead.
But wait, how would you argue about the hip socket of
You're asking another question.
Let me do a little follow-up, little comment on this. I could imagine you might say, too, about the moths, you know, big deal, it's just microevolution. The young earthers, that's okay with them. Microevolution change within species.
Right.
But what's interesting, though, is Brandon would say that, well, you know, about 4,000 years ago, there was a worldwide flood, and every air breather was extinct unless it was saved on the ark. So all the animals today emanated out of those animals that were saved 4,000 years ago. So usually these people are put down for saying, you know, you say you don't believe in macroevolution, yet your microevolution goes on in order way too fast than modern science would accept. So isn't that kind of ironic to say, like, you don't believe in macroevolution, yet microevolution is like a billion times faster?
Well, you misstate it like that, sure.
We're getting into another debate here.
Let's
hold off on that. Gentlemen up here, Bruce Shirk.
Okay, let me start off by saying, and I mean this somewhat lovingly, neither one of you are qualified to really address this topic, so I don't know why, in your right mind, you're trying to sit there like experts on this. I, too, have an electronics background, as you do, Church, Mr. Church, but I would never attempt to address this subject because, again, it is way out of your field of expertise. I would also say that, I'm going to direct this now at you again, sir. I would also say that the premise of your argument basically is to disprove what is being discussed, which is not a very powerful argument. What I mean by that is everything that science tries to understand takes time. There's going to be disagreement. I don't care what the subject is. It sometimes takes hundreds of years, maybe thousands of years, to get something correct. That's the normal way a scientific process works. So I kind of don't understand where you're coming from when you say, this guy said this, and this guy said that, and therefore that disproves that. Of course it does. They're evolving their process. The question that I have is, what qualifies you, sir, to really say that you have the answer in believing in what the Bible says when the Bible doesn't say anything. It's a 30,000-foot perspective at best, whereas science can at least say, we understand step one, two, and we don't get the rest yet.
I think I'm going to shelve that question. It sounds ad hominem. You're asking what qualifies him. He's taken, both these people have prepared for the debate.
I had a question about the birdie. You were talking about that, the nerve in the whale, mm-hmm. and the sharks and all that type of stuff. And it seems like general evolutionary theory would say that things go from, you know, some state, and when the certain traits are good, then they live on longer and they provide some benefit, and so they get passed down. And so that would seem if we went from fish and then to mammals, and mammals got that, then they went back into the water and kept that, and yet you say the shortest distance is the better one. Why was this brought out as, you know, some preeminent trait or some important trait or some change that was propagated as a beneficial piece of evolution, and yet we'd call it useless or silly or too long a path? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the answer is the laryngeal nerve. It basically, it's because of the physical structure of where it was placed and how it was placed in the fish. It basically got trapped and stuck in a certain spot. So as things moved, it was stuck and forced to move with it. It can't, the way to solve it would be to cut it and rewire it, and evolution can't redesign something like that. So it's basically taking what it has and trying to manipulate it. So the best it can do is, it's like, you know, if you're going to move the whole room, everything that's stuck there has got to move with it. So it just got stuck. Not all the nerves, I think there's more than one laryngeal nerve and a bunch of the other ones. I think there's other ones that don't have that problem. It's just the structure of this one.
Can I address that?
Yeah.
So evolution can take something very much like a wolf, in fact, the size of a wolf, turn it into a blue whale in just a few million years, and yet evolution can't cut a nerve and rewire it?
Right. Because it takes, according to evolution, there's basically modifications to existing things. And this thing
was... these are some pretty big modifications, a wolf to a whale.
Yeah, but they're successive modifications. It's not like somebody coming in there and cutting and rewiring. Just to fix this problem, you'd have to like cut it and rewire it.
Okay. Well, one other thing to mention about that, and I think maybe what you were getting at was that evolution is supposed to be based on benefits, on helpful things. And, you know, it takes energy, it takes work, it takes food, it takes all kinds of things to support a structure, to grow structures. If something is not beneficial, it's a waste. And in the terms of natural selection, wasting energy is tantamount to death. It's not helpful, and so why does it still survive if it's wasting all this energy to build the structure that it could do differently?
Right. So I think the answer is that it's good enough. So the real problem is if you're going to say God intelligently designed things, you can look on the internet. There's all these cases of terrible design. So it's like that's not intelligent design. That's a bad designer. It's a dumb designer. There's quite a few examples of this.
Again, just because you don't know what it's for doesn't mean it has no purpose.
Okay. There was a hand up over here a while ago. I'm trying to remember faces. Over here, now you in the back, there, and then there.
Okay. Hey, first, well, I'll mention my preference. I'm absolutely a creation.
Okay.
And mention that the 99% of species are gone, that really is consistent with creation, with death, because we're not getting more species, we're getting less. But what I really want to address, the question maybe for both of you, with the whale, an animal in water, land in water, modern Darwinism would require mutations and selection. So as far as I know, you'd have to have chemical mutagens, you'd have to have mutagenic mutagens. It would seem to me that in the oceans, from my point of view, can you identify something that would even have the same level of mutagens for the DNA, either chemical or radiogenic, in the deep ocean as you would have on land? Why would you expect these kinds of changes to I think you said 1,500 generations. That really surprised me. Maybe I misheard that. But it's amazing. That it seems to me like that's an environment in which you have a very reduced rate of mutagens, and so less opportunity for change. If you could ever get a positive change, I think really true science doesn't find it all. You
know, address that both. Which okay. one will take
first? I'll go first.
What was the question again?
Mutagens.
The question is, why would you expect a high rate of mutagens, either chemical or radiogenic, in a deep sea, whereas if you're getting mutagens, if you're getting radiogenic mutagens, say, from the atmosphere, the air, you expect a higher rate on the surface of the land. I wouldn't expect it in the deep sea. I'm asking about what kind of environment you would expect in the deep sea. What kind of model would you have to really keep that mutation rate going to allow evolution to progress? I just say it's nonsense.
Okay, well, yeah. One point I think is very important to make is that I think you can say that evolution is a fact without knowing the mechanism exactly. And the reason why is because you look at all the evidence, you can see the progression. For example, mammals in the ocean, mammals in the land, look at the time frames, look how they're the same. So we can see that it actually happened. Exactly how, we're not sure. I mean, random mutation, natural selection, yeah, that used to be kind of the main thing. There's also epigenetics, which shows how the environment can switch on and off and affect your genes and hereditary. There's also horizontal gene transfer. These are some kind of recent things. So, you know, there's still, I think, a lot of mysteries as far as what all the mechanisms are and all the, there's a whole bunch of it. But I think that evolution happens, you can see as a fact, without knowing how exactly. And people who are critics of evolution say, oh, well, if you don't know how, then I'm not going to accept it. And I think that would be rash and not intelligent to do.
All right. So. A few things to mention. First of all, we do not see the evidence for evolution. You look at the very last page, the very bottom of my, last page of my handout, and I have some evolutionary trees here. These come from Macmillan Illustrated Encyclopedia of Dinosaurs and Prehistoric Animals. These are the supposed evolutionary trees for reptiles and birds and mammals and so on. You can read about that there. The dotted lines are the supposed, let's see, the caption says, solid bars show the known fossil record of a group. Dotted lines denote the possible evolutionary relationships between groups. So you can see the actual evolution, the linking of one group to another, the dotted lines. We don't have the evidence, we don't have the fossils to show evolution from one to the next to the next. So the actual evolution is assumed. What we have are stable creatures in the fossil record. But as far as rapid mutation goes, and this is something I brought up at the last debate. I don't really feel like I got any kind of an answer for it. If creatures are supposed to evolve rapidly at key points in history, which is what the modern theory says, we see stability for a long time and then rapid evolution from time to time. And that's supposed to be because of, you know, stressful conditions, environmental problems that drive them toward new and radical new things. Well, we've got an incredible amount of pollution right now, deforestation. The environment right now is under an incredible amount of pressure, and insects reproduce, some of them every week, some of them, you know, faster than that. We've probably seen at least a few thousand generations of insects since the Industrial Revolution started 200 years ago. Why aren't we seeing this rapid evolution right now among the insects? Seems like this would be a perfect time for that, to actually see it in action, but we don't.
What about pesticide-resistant insects?
Is that evolution, or is that based
Absolutely.
On is that based on micro mutations?
Right. This is the same thing.
In the back,
I'm sorry, microevolution.
Yeah. So, first of all, according to evolution, things are getting better, correct? Because they're evolving to be better.
Not necessarily. It's just radiation in all directions.
Okay. Well, my question is you use the fact of those whales who shed their teeth as proof of evolution. So, according to evolution, why have these whales figured out if they don't need them? Do you think that they would stop producing?
Okay, who's directed primarily?
Yeah, Sinbergen, sorry.
Well, it's not a matter of whales figuring things out. I don't think they don't have a choice in how they're made in the womb.
It wouldn't make sense if evolution is getting better that trait is still being possessed.
It's not necessarily better. I mean, for example, look at us as humans. I mean, we got better brains than animals. In fact, the most complex thing in the entire universe is our brain. But we don't have good armor. We don't have good claws and teeth. You know, lions beat us and some other things. So it's really about filling your ecological niche. And okay. If you can do that, you'll stick around. That's why the monkeys are still there and the apes are still there, because they have a niche.
So how is the fact that they still have an evolutionary improvement if you're saying that it doesn't even matter?
Well, basically, they're saying in embryology, why are things being made that the animal is going to later absorb, reabsorb, or get rid of? And from an evolutionary standpoint, it makes sense because it's just the building process it goes through. It inherited this building process, and then other genes turn on later and turn things off and stuff like that. So it makes sense. But if your alternate hypothesis is God is making something from scratch, boom, there's a killer whale, or there's a baleen whale. Why would he design a baleen whale so when it's in the womb it creates teeth that's going to later lose, you know, and also make fur that's going to lose, and stuff like that.
Okay, can I address this? Okay, when it comes to the teeth in the embryos of baleen whales, as I said, you know, it's possible God created all the whales in one original kind, and then they had the genetic diversity that they could speciate. Creationists don't disagree with speciation. Changes in species, but we do disagree with changes in a genus or family, anything higher than that. It's possible all the whales came from one original type, maybe two, maybe three, we don't know for sure. So I would not have a problem with you saying that, you know, the baleens and the toothed whales share a common ancestor, but it's not a wolf or a river otter. The other thing to point out, when it comes to, you know, why would God create things that in the embryo, they build things up and then they just get reabsorbed. It made me think of building a building, a structure. You got, you know, you put up scaffolding, and then you build the structure. And then what do? You take down the scaffolding. Why? Because you don't need it anymore. You prepare for something, you do it, and then you take away the preparation. An operating table, they, you know, lay out all the tools, that, you know, and everything. They do their procedure, and then they remove the preparation. So it could be that these structures, as they're being built in the womb, looks like they have no function. Later on, they get reabsorbed. Maybe they did have a function to help the building of something in the course of it, and then they're no longer needed, so they go away.
Yeah, well, the scientists thought of that, and their conclusion is that there's no need for it.
How do we know? Just because you don't know if there's a purpose doesn't mean there is no purpose.
Well, okay. We've come to that before.
Okay.
It's more of a simpler question because I think, in all true respect, probably 90% of the people here, what you're both sharing is probably going over their heads.
So thanks a lot.
In all respect, I said. The topic about the God of the gaps, could you rephrase what you meant, and then I'll ask my question. You said that, what did you say that the evolutionists would say?
The idea of the, quote, God of the gaps argument is evolutionists will say, the creationists will say, you know, we find a feature, we find something going on, maybe the, you know, the Big Bang or whatever, we find something we can't really explain, we don't know how it happened, and so the creationists would jump to the conclusion, oh, God must have done it. So that's basically filling in the gaps in our knowledge with the simplistic explanation, God did it. And as a criticism toward creationists, I would level the same criticism toward evolutionists. We don't know how something happened, or we don't know the purpose of something, therefore they jump to the conclusion it has no purpose.
Now, the question then off of that is, what type of evolutionists or non-believers are you referring to? Because probably the ones that would, the Christians that would say, for example, that therefore God did it are probably not as advanced and articulated and studied as you were, which you would never say that. You're beyond that. So what type of evolutionists or non-believers are you referring to? Just the ones that really haven't studied this? And if so, I would encourage you to maybe qualify that in your next debate so that you don't look like you're making an ad hominem statement, but you're being very specific exactly the type of people who will be just as dogmatic and dismissive as an assumption. You know, as like creationists.
My last debate, the subject came up of God of the Gaps. I think it was when we were debating. Anyway, so I have had those suggestions directed at me. In all reality, you know, when evolutionists say that we believe in the God of gaps, and when I say that evolutionists do the very same thing for evolution, those are both generalizations. Not all creationists, you know, like Bernie said, and I completely agree with him from the beginning, he is not speaking for all atheists, I'm not speaking for all Christians or creationists, and I certainly don't think that, you know, you can put all creationists or all atheists into a box. So they are generalizations when we say these things.
All right. Right there, one minute. Why are you here, Mike?
Kristen, a question of Mr. Church. Creationists, how, over what length of time did life, was life created, and how long ago, and how come the fossil, it seems like everything ought to be the same age in the fossil record, and is creation still going on? Is God still coming out with new models of things?
Good questions. According to Genesis chapter 1, and if we take this literally, which creationists do, God created everything in 6 literal days. So we start with, created basically the universe and the earth, later filled it with the sun, the moon, the stars, but, you know, successively created these things, but over a course of 6 literal days. If we look at the genealogies in the Bible, Genesis chapter 5, which takes us from Adam to Noah, chapter 11 takes us from Noah to Abraham, and when we start looking at history and what we can pin down historically and try to line things up in the older parts of the Bible with history, so we can get kind of piece together these full timelines, what we end up coming up with, it looks like the 6 days worth of creation occurred around 6,000 years ago. And we don't know that, you know, specifically for sure, but around 6,000 years ago. Now, when it comes to the fossil record and where that came from, creationist point of view, and why it looks the way it does, we believe that the fossil record was formed during the flood of Noah's time. It was a catastrophic global flood, ravaged the entire planet, and everything, the Bible says God created things in their distinct kinds, not species, but kinds. So kinds might be a genus, might be a family in some cases. They can speciate to some extent, but they can't go, you know, a dog cannot become a cat, for example. The fossil record looks the way it does because the dynamics of a global flood, and creationists have tried to model this, and obviously it's a very complex process. And they've done some good things in trying to figure out why these beds look the way they do and why the fossil record seems to be the way it is. But I would also suggest that the specific order of the fossils that is put forth in these books, they look like, you know, fish to amphibians to reptiles to birds and so on, is very patchy. It's pieced together. It's very piecemeal. It does not look nearly that clean cut in the actual rocks. Evolutionists have to do a lot of interpreting of the data to try to put these trees together. And creationists would say that, you know, they're not doing a very good job of that. They're not being fair to the data itself, to the fossils and what we find. So there are definite disagreements on how to interpret the fossil record.
Just a short comment. So Brandon said that there was one major global flood in the whole world probably about 4,000 years ago. 4,500 years ago, instead of, you know, having a Earth that is something like 4 billion years old. But anyway, the evolutionists have a common saying that, well, you know, if you want to disprove evolution, just find me a rabbit in the Cambrian strata, the Cambrian fossil record.
This goes to some of that playing with the data I mentioned. If we find a rabbit, because they've already decided rabbits evolved much, much later, if we do find a rabbit in a rock layer, they're not going to say it's a Cambrian layer. They're going to say it's a, you know, Miocene layer or something like that.
But you're saying it's all the same layer? It's all one flood?
It was all one flood. The layering happened because of, hydrological processes. But yeah, we might find Precambrian basement rock with a rabbit on the very next layer. And they would say, well, that rabbit layer, that's not just, that didn't come right after the Cambrian, or the Precambrian, that's not Cambrian. That rabbit layer is Miocene. How do we know? Well, it has a rabbit in it. So it's kind of circular reasoning. If we find a rabbit in a layer, it's a layer that the evolutionists would say, well, rabbits lived at that time, therefore, it's, you know, it can't be Cambrian. So how can we ever possibly find a rabbit in a Cambrian layer? When we find a rabbit in the layer, they'll never say this is a Cambrian.
We're running short on time.
Either my watch is wrong or this is 6 minutes slow.
Yeah, it is.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I got 7:40.
I just figured my watch was 7:40.
It's never right. 7:38.
Thanks. Yes, sir.
Couple of things. Wouldn't you agree that all
who?
Adolescent, I guess it would be you. I mean, I think Bernie would probably agree with you. But you don't believe that all evolution is all generated from DNA, whether it's macroevolution or microevolution. It's all the same thing. It all starts at the micro level, no matter if it turns something small into something big. You know, it's a big change whether it's your leg falling off and changing into something else or anything. It all starts at the micro level. And as far as the Bible goes, it makes me hard to understand how you literally believe in the flood theory, right?
Yes.
Well, how could it have been possible that so many creatures that were on another planet they didn't even know existed were saved?
Okay. Good points. Let me address them both very quickly. First of all, microevolution and macroevolution, and I mentioned this in the last debate, they are based on two entirely different mechanisms. In the DNA, you have a certain amount of variability. That's why I might have a child that has hair color different than mine, because I carry the traits for different hair colors. We all have variability in our genes. That is what microevolution and antibiotic resistance, that is what that is based on, is the variability that is already there. Darwin thought that by shuffling these genes, you'd be able to come up with wildly new things, but we now know that is not true. You can, you know, shuffle these genes all you want. It's like shuffling a deck of cards. You will never come up with a different combination than the full set that's already there. In order to go from, you know, a fish to a reptile, a monkey to a man, you need new information. That is macroevolution. That is based on genetic mutations. They're supposed to add information to the DNA. So they are two very different mechanisms. Creationists agree with microevolution, what we prefer to call adaptation. We do not agree with macroevolution. Now, when it comes to the Bible, the flood, I'm sorry, what was your question concerning that?
It's hard to understand how that story can be accepted as anything but a parable when that book was written at the time. There was parts of the world that they didn't even know existed.
Okay.
You know, and there were creatures that lived there that they didn't know that were needing to be saved. Except.
Okay. Before the flood, what did the world, what did the geography look like? What did the continents look like? When we look at the fossil record, we look at, you know, and by the way, creationists do agree with a lot of what evolutionists do. It looks like there was one global continent. They call it Pangaea. They say there were two or three, don't know about that. But anyway, it looks like there was a global continent. And all of these continents were connected. Creatures could have come from all over the world to the ark to be preserved. The Bible says God brought them there. It doesn't say Noah gathered them. It was during the flood that the plates of the earth were broken up, that the continents separated, and we end up with the geography we have today. But even after the flood, there was an ice age, there were land bridges and things like that. Creatures could have spread out and filled these continents. So that's not a problem either.
Doesn't seem disingenuous that creationists can believe in some of science, but not others, and pick and choose, kind of like cherry pick what they want to agree with and not?
If it's good data, we would certainly agree with it. If I say 2 + 2 = 4, Bernie is obligated to agree with me, even though he disagrees with most of what I've said here today. If it's good data, we absolutely agree with it, but we look at the data, we see if it's good, we see, you know, the internal consistency of it and if it conforms to logic, and we look at how the scientists worked with the data to see if we think it was done well or not. We absolutely agree with some of what they do.
And just a short comment too, like when it comes to macroevolution changes beyond the species level too, Brandon just implied too that, you know, mutations are what give you new creatures. And like I said, since Darwin's time, there's things we have discovered, such as epigenetics, where the environment actually affects the body and affects the hereditary of the next generation. And also horizontal gene transfer, where you get basically a virus, you get more DNA that's a playground, basically, in your DNA to play around with. There's a lot of so-called junk in the DNA that's just kind of a playground for things to happen in. So. Those are just two things we know about. There could be more still yet to discover. So these are things that Darwin didn't know about DNA.
True.
So.
Real quick, got a quick one?
Around the time of the ark, how many continents were there? kinds do you think there were, and how big was the ark?
The Bible gives the dimensions for it. I don't remember exactly. I've seen models of this kind of scale to the model train cars, you know, the standard, you know, O or H or whatever the model is for the train cars. And the ark would have been, I'm thinking the length of something like six of these. 450 feet, thank you.
450 feet.
Okay. The ark was huge. Now, as far as how many kinds of animals were on it, a creationist by the name of John Woodmorafi did a very thorough study of this in a book called The Ark, A Feasibility Study. Very good book. Looked at all kinds of features of this. But what he ended up doing is, and creationists had done studies of this before, looking into what kinds are there, how many different kinds are there. Okay, you have a lion, a tiger, and a leopard, and a cheetah. Are all these different kinds? Or is all of this one kind? So we've tried to pin down how many kinds are there, and it looks like if we consider just the genus level of the taxonomy, you know, classes and orders and whatnot, if we just look at the genus of the animals that would have been taken onto the ark, Woodmorafi calculated there would have been a little under 16,000 animals, 15,000 something, I don't remember the exact number. And he calculated, okay, how much food would they need? How much space would that take on the ark? Assuming that they took all of their water, which is probably wouldn't need to, but how much room would that take on the ark? Talked about cleanup, talked about light, talked about heat, all kinds of features. So if you really want a good look at the ark and how reasonable it was, I would recommend that book.
You know, it sounds like a good answer when you say, how many different kinds are there on the ark? Well, the answer is in this book. It's all worked out, and, you know, it's all in there. I had that book, and I was curious because, you know, what do you define as a kind? How many birds? What birds were they? What did you use? Guess what? There's no details. How many birds were there? How many species? You know, there was a number of 1,000. Okay, what were they? There's no answers for that. So all you're doing is trusting this guy just pulling numbers out of the air. There's 1,000 species of bears. What kind of bears?
He didn't pull numbers out of the air. He pulled numbers out of articles that had previously been published. And I'd mentioned that
there's no reference notes or anything. I tried to track it down.
There are a lot of references. I can email them to you. They're right out of the book.
Okay, we're at the end of our Q&A, and prearranged, Bernie gets a 2 minute. Brandon gets a 2 minute closing statement.
Yes.
And Bernie follows him with a 2 minute closing statement. Gentlemen, get ready to start your engines. Okay?
Yes. So, whale evolution is supposed to be a slam dunk for the theory. You guys probably read the National Geographic quote on the invitation to this debate. It said, quote, once celebrated by creationists as the best evidence against evolution, maybe evolution's most elegant proof. In 2001, Thwaisen wrote an article, Whale Origin is a Poster Child for Macroevolution. I've read a number of evolutionists who've said this is one of the best evidences for evolution. Others have said this is the very best evidence for evolution. Really? And this is it? This is the best they've got? You can imagine how bad the rest of the evidence is. On our internet debates, I've pointed out a lot of cases where evolutionists tend to ignore data that doesn't fit their theories. When you cherry-pick the data, you can make it say whatever you want, and we've seen that here too. These huge 2008 study and the ones that came before, they glossed over specific details. The evolutionary trees get overinflated with species that are made up of little more than a few teeth or a few ribs. You can see that on my handout at the front page. The scientists focus on a few features that seem to show a path while completely ignoring the fact that most features don't. Then there's the issue of convergent evolution and reversals, features appearing, disappearing, bouncing all over the place. Again, if we were to arrange vehicles into evolutionary trees, we'd see the same thing. There is no path there. Of course, this completely fits with the intelligent design point of view, creationist view, that the fossil record was not laid down over hundreds of millions of years. It was the result of a year-long worldwide flood. And the book of Romans, we read, quote, although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. And I think that sounds a lot like evolution. I think it is foolish to turn away from God and chase after these stories that they're really pretty ridiculous. As Christians, we don't need to be afraid of the science. God created nature, and when it gets down to the details, when you really get down to the details, the science supports the Bible.
free. You have 2 minutes.
Okay, so I want to press upon you that you have 2 choices. It's not just whether you want to accept evolution or not, really, in the big picture. It's either things evolved, whether by God's direction or not, or they were made by special creation. Poof, 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 poof. Random things, that's the way God made things. Poof, poof. Then maybe on one whale, poof, and then some other whales descended from that. One bear, poof, and other bears came from that. The next thing I want to say is consider the multiple lines of evidence. For example, you can go to talkorigins.net, and there's nine different, that's almost independent ways. They claim to be independent. I'm not sure if it's all the way independent, but for example, the paleontological evidence, which is the fossils, morphological evidence, like looking at the anvil of the ear, molecular evidence, studying the DNA, which is quite extensive lately, vestigial evidence, which is these unused parts, such as muscles for ears, and they no longer have the external ears. Why would they have muscles then? Obviously, it's from they inherited it. Embryological evidence, things like having leg bones and they don't have legs anymore, just leftover. The geochemical evidence, where you can analyze their teeth to determine what kind of water they lived in. The paleo-environmental evidence, where you can see the corresponding other fossils that were found around with it. Paleo-biogeographic evidence, which says, you know, if it's a later whale, it's going to be found in lots of places, and yes, that's where it's found, and if it was an earlier whale, it'll probably be in certain places, be local places, because that's where the fresh water is, and that kind of lines up. Chronological evidence, why would the mammals go back in the ocean? Because of the extinction event. There was a ripe niche there to exploit. I'll just finish with this too, that secular humanism is the belief system I ascribe to. It's a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking. And so why would you believe in the supernatural? I don't think there's any evidence for it. And the evidence seems to be the God of the gaps kind of argument from ignorance. So I'll leave it with that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank both of you for inviting me to be your moderator. Hope I didn't offend you too badly. And I didn't mean to be offensive. Years, but it didn't seem to be fitting. I would like to invite all of you who would like to come Saturday morning, 9 o'clock at Rolling Hills in Tualatin. We have a meeting that we meet once a month called Design Science Association. I usually set up the speakers for that. This Saturday I'll be speaking. And my topic is Creation Science 101. What's it all about? Now, I'm the opposite of you, because 16 years ago, I was a confirmed evolutionist, and I would have argued with anybody who tried to tell me different. I'm a confirmed creationist now. I did take time, and I looked into it, and I found much lacking in evolutionary arguments, and if you'll come listen to my presentation, hopefully, if I get my voice back, I'll be able to convince you that there's a lot of reasons to believe that God created and not very long ago. Thanks for coming. Appreciate any help you give and take a chair.